Yeah, hello and welcome. So this project and this talk is done actually by Michael and me. So again, a Schröder and Schröder production. And it's about our new side project, Gekito. Goal to have an embedded Linux with long-term maintenance support. So why Gekito at all? On one hand, OpenSUSE is currently no good fit for the embedded world. And yes, you might say, but there are plenty of images and lots, especially the ARM people invested lots of time to support Raspberries and plenty of other hardware. And that's right. But still, all these images are quite focused in a way that, as it's done on our SLES servers, you have a complete full Linux distribution stack, and the classical embedded world looks a bit different. There you have only the absolute necessary in your image. You need very fast build times, you need cross-architecture support, and so on. And currently, our distribution is no good fit there. On the other side, the embedded world suffers by not having long-term maintenance support. That means often the images are just initially created and the vendor has a problem to update them later simply because the code base is not maintained in a way like an enterprise is. So it's, and you look at projects like Jocto. They have a proof of concept distribution and you can build something there, but there's no guarantee to have it maintained somehow. So our goal is to have the best of both worlds here. And that means enhancing OpenSUSE in first place to be the best choice for any successful embedded Linux project by enhancing OpenSUSE itself and by adding the necessary tooling for that. So Gekito is not a single thing. Gekito is really the ecosystem. We have OpenSUSE, the sources and binaries, because embedded developers not always want to recompile everything. It should be possible that you can recompile everything, but you may want to reuse existing binaries because this is also seen as a value, not only for the build times, but also for certifications. Then you have third-party sources and binaries you might want to use. Maybe any upstream Docker container or some Go libraries or whatever. And you have your own additional value as developer. All this you want to bring on some concrete hardware, and therefore we need templates for every hardware we want to support, every specific hardware. In general, this will be only hardware which supports Linux, so everything smaller or which is not supporting Linux, so something like an Arduino will most likely not be supported by us. The smallest thing we might start with is a Raspberry Zero, something like this, quite antique ARM V6. And of course, a standard Raspberry is our starting point at the moment. For this, we will have initially templates, but not limited to that. And what's really new is the Pebble tool you see here. So this project builder will combine all these resources and build the results the embedded developer needs. The image for his hardware and also any kind of SDK for his developers who might want to build applications on top of these images. So the Pebble tool, Michael.
Yes, this is. Oops, this, I thought it. Go, go, go. Yes, the camera. Hello, everyone. So I'm gonna do the section about the Pebble tool. And As Adrian said, pbuild is the thing that takes all the input, be it sources or binaries, and creates the results, be it an image on SDK. If you look like things like other distributions like Yocto, every distribution has something similar. For Yocto, it's Bitbake and VFP build. We didn't start from scratch, obviously. Otherwise, we couldn't present you the tool right now, because building a tool from scratch really is lots of work. So what we did is we kind of build it on top of the existing build tool we already have in SUSE, which is called build. And build is also the thing that OBS uses for building. So it's the fundamental building block we have if we speak about building sources into binaries. As it's built on, it's created on top of build, it also supports everything build does. So you can use it to create RPMs, you can use it to create Debian packages, Arch Linux packages, but also Kiwi images, and basically anything that build also supports. The difference is, of course, build itself works on just only one package, whereas pbuild works on a set of packages. So you can think of, you have your project, the project consists of multiple packages. So maybe you want to compile some binaries and binary RPMs, and then do a composition of the binary's RPM into an image. So you would have a package for each of your binaries, and then a package that creates the image. And that's what pbuild does. And so you can think of it as similar to the OpenSUSE build service that already exists, but it's kind of single shot. So you run pbuild goes to the packages, looks if anything needs to be built. So it checks if the sources, if the thing, the artifacts it has are built with the same sources you have as input, and if there's a source change, it redoes the build, and it also does the build in the correct order so that everything works out in the end. And after everything is up to date, pbuild exits again, so you get the shell prompt. So you start it, you wait a minute or two or so. If it's a big project, then you wait 10 minutes or so. We won't get in an hour, multiple hour range, because that's not what embedded people are kind of used to. So that if you rebuild a complete OpenSUSE distributions, you need to wait a couple of hours, but embedded world is small. So hopefully just a couple of minutes, and then you have the result. And it's incremental. So if you're not happy with the result, then you can do source changes and run pbuild again, and then it rebuilds only the things it needs to. Builds are done with the build tool, and we modified the build tool so that everything can be done as non-root user. So last year, the build would only work if it's done by user root, but now you can also do it as a normal non-root user, and then it will automatically switch to KVM, and we changed the tool so that this works out fine. So you can basically, every user can do the builds. Yeah, next slide, please. So here's an example, basically. So you have a directory with two subdirectories. This is kind of taken from the shells project of the Open Build Service. So you have the ash and the set shell in there. And if you do an ls on the directories, you see the usual setup. So you have a spec file in the package, you have the tarball in the package, and maybe some patches. And then what you do, you run pbuild. You have to also specify distribution. So pbuild needs to know that you want to build against lib 15.3, unless you're bootstrapping, of course. But our examples here need a distribution to build against. And then pbuild does all the builds. In that example, there was one succeeded build and one failed build. And the artifacts are stored in an underscore build.sl15.3, because that's what I specified as a distribution directory, and the architecture is also appended to the path. And there you see in the result directory, you have a subdirectory for each package again, and then there's a job history file that's basically a log that of all builds that has that were done. Okay, next slide.
And I just want to add, these are examples for RPM, but of course, all formats are supported. So if you don't want to build an RPM and you just want to include your compile in a container or image build, you can do this as well.
So you probably saw in the example there was a big tar file in it, and you usually don't want to do that as an embedded developer. What you do with say if you come from the Yocto work, you know Bitbag, what you do is your sources don't contain those big tarballs, and what you do instead is you reference the tarball on some remote server. And this is also what pbuild supports. So you can put a reference into the spec file that references the tarball on say the Free Software Foundation's website, and then pbuild will download the tarball before starting the build. But the tarball doesn't need to be part of the sources. And this has one big adventure. And the adventure is that if you do a git checkout of your source, the git checkout doesn't need to include the tarball. So it's far, the checkout is fast, and you can, and your repository is small, and it's basically it doesn't need to do in the tarball. It makes everything just too big and sluggish. And there are two types of assets. So those are usually called remote assets. There are two types, and we distinguish, and this is the immutable asset. This is an asset where the context is fixed. You usually specify that with an checksum, so it's an SHA 256 checksum or so. And then pbuild can verify that the checksum matches. And there's also mutable assets. That is, if you specify an URL with no checksum, this tells pbuild this is an asset that changes over time and maybe needs to be refreshed from time to time. Okay, next slide, please. So here's an example on the next slide. So I took the SED spec file from the OpenSUSE distribution and added this remote asset information. And so the good thing is with spec files, you already can specify the URL in this spec file syntax. So if you have a source zero entry here in the spec file, it can be an URL, and usually RPM ignores everything in front of the last slash and checks if the last thing of the path is available on disk. But you can already specify the URLs. So what we then do is we need to tell people that the next line, the next source is a remote asset. And you do that by specifying this annotation there, hash bang remote asset. And this is also if you want to have a pinned asset, like with the tarball, you don't want anybody fiddling around with the remote tarball because you want to have reproducible builds, then you can specify the SAH checksum here, like in the first example. Of course, the dot, 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 this is something I stripped out so that it fits on the slide here. And then another example is down there. This is our pyhole ftl.spec. And in that example, the asset is not a file, but in Git repository. So this is also what pbuild supports. So we have instead of remote asset, we specify an URL. This is because the Git checkout is a directory, and the directory cannot be specified as a source for RPM, because RPM then says that it's a directory, not a file. So then the build has to do something fancy with the directory later on. But this is basically how you can include a Git checkout in a build with that remote asset mechanism. Next slide, please. So here's what we currently support in the pbuild tool, how you do the external asset declarations. I already showed you how to do that in the spec file. We also implemented it some different ways. So you can also have a remote asset in the Kiwi recipe file. You do that because it's XML. You can't use the hash bang syntax, but you need to do it with an XML comment. So less than sign, bang, minus minus, OBS minus remote, asset, and then the URL. And we also pass the Arch Linux package build files, which also can contain URLs and the checksum. There we don't need to do any extension because Arch Linux already supports that natively. And we also have support for Fedora fed package sources file. This is kind of an external file they have in your sources that declares that this file name is available with this checksum. And then there's a specific server in Fedora, which you need to specify where you can then fetch, where the people tool then fetches the sources from via the specified checksum. So this is quite different from what we have in OBS currently. But as we'll show you later on, we also want to change OBS to support those kind of remote assets. Next slide, please. It's back to Adrian.
Yeah, so the one large cornerstone in Gekito is the cross-architecture build. And we have some setups now. The GCC team provides also real cross compilers now. So don't mix it up with the cross compilers we used to have before, which were just the backends to have an accelerated compilation just with the compiler backend. Now we will have full cross compilers, and these will become part of the distribution. Currently, they are not yet. So what people does also is now to resolve the dependencies in such situations always two times. So on the user system, we build the build environment, which is usually KVM or change root or Docker or whatever, but by default KVM. And inside of this build environment, there is a default path compiled in the compilers, so some user architecture name sysroot, and build will also install into the sysroot additional packages of the target architecture. So to make it more easy is mightly enhance the people that we can classify or dependencies. Typically, all dependencies gets installed only in the sysroot, but sometimes you want to have them in the host system because it's way faster to have them as native compiled. And therefore, we have markers which can either be added in the spec file or in the config to classify which packages should be installed where.
So usually you have tools you want to install native, like make or so, or you have libraries which you want to install in the sysroot. And so you have, these are two types of dependencies, and you have to mark them as so that people knows what they are.
Yeah. The same we can do for imaging. So we enhanced Kiwi together with Marco Schaefer. So Kiwi now is also able to do a cross architecture image creation. And that's harder than it's actually sounds in the beginning, because all the scripts and packages you installed for actually needs to be emulated. So all post scripts from RPM spec files still need to be executed on the target architecture, because we can't change every spec file to allow cross installation. And therefore, we have a plugin which installs a helper application, a QEMU Linux user helper, which enables the emulation inside of the target image for the build time. The good thing is that only the absolute necessary gets emulated. So all native things like the zipper and so on, which is doing the heavy work, is still native. So we still have very fast image builds, and all IO operations and the decompression are still very fast therefore. And then we have an OBS a project, and there we provide some helpers. Currently also the cross compilers, as long as they are not merged into the distributions. But then there is also some small package called cross AA base, which provides some prepper tools and macro RPM macros, which can be used for cross building. And we provide there also an SDK, because there's always the image developer in the embedded world, but there's also the application developer. And the application developer are usually working on their systems, often maybe even not even on Linux, but on some Windows system. They run their IDE, and they can get their sys root, which can be used then to do the cross compilation and the emulators to test the application. Also, you find the Gekito setup tool there. So it's a very simple tool actually, but it's a service which runs on boot time. And this allows the user who wants to deploy an image to configure it, especially the network. So he can just place an ifconfig file in the boot directory. Specify his wireless settings there, for example, or he can just create an SSHD file and he will get an SSH server started by default. Why in boot? Because some of the images mount or provide the boot device as a FAT partition. And that's very nice for Microsoft and macOS users, because they can mount this partition directly and edit it, and they don't need a Linux to deploy this image. Of course, there's a README file for them describing how he can set it up. We have some examples. Some of you have found them already. So I just want to briefly mention them. So the standard template is the image Raspberry Pi 4. We are currently down to 500 megabyte root file system, uncompressed. It's still too large in our opinion, but it's, when you compare it with the JOS image, it's much smaller. The main reason why we got so small was that we do not have or any provide any zipper, or not even RPM. So RPM is not available there, because the images are supposed to be replaced on an update. They are not supposed to be maintained like any server or VM. Just to demonstrate that the classical image builds, the JOS files, are also working with pbuild. We have also there the JOS image, but it's not intended to be the main image for us. It's, you can use pbuild to build any kind of large components, images. You can large server images. You can build any kind of sets of containers and whatever, but that's not the main purpose here. The main purpose is really to support smaller hardware. Besides the base systems, we have also some examples how to build concrete workloads, and basically two examples at the moment. For one, the p-hole. The p-hole example shows how to do a cross compilation of a package. And afterwards, it builds also the matching image for that. So you can build an Raspberry Pi image again using it. And then we have also another example, the K3S. And this is interesting because it goes away from our typical approach that everything must be isolated and fully reproducible. This is demonstrating that you can actually download resources during build from the network. So you need to specify the --vm network switch there. And it will download the K3S installer script, and this one will install download then plenty of more stuff. So it's not only 500 megabyte rootfs as written there after the first boot, so it will take way more, but the initial image is 500 megabyte large. So just as an example that you can actually also do these dirty things. What about OBS? Yeah, in first place, we focus on the build tooling, but we also enhance OBS as a side job. For example, the cross-architecture build support is already added to OBS, so you can already do cross-architecture builds. Pbuild itself is completely agnostic to how the sources for Pbuild are managed. So the assets are one thing, but another thing is where you store your own build descriptions, your files. This is, Pbuild just expected to be there, so you can use Git or anything else. However, we will of course expect that Git will be used usually, and we will teach at some point in time also OBS to deal with Git managed projects. Actually, we have did plan to have done this already, but we were swamped with some other projects, and there's also not so much interest from the Slay people at the moment. So this was one of the projects which got a bit pushed behind, but it's still in our plan. A demo. So I hope you can see my screen. Yeah. So what I did here, I have just three directories, nothing else than a Git clone, but I did this already. The OBS build is a build script as we provided. So you just need, it should work on any Linux system. You do not need to install any RPM package. You just need the build script checkout. And then you can go to some project template file or create your own. And what you see here, basically, that's a typical setup, is you have a README file telling you something about it, how to call it. Then there is a underscore pbuild file, and it might remind you a little bit like to the project meta file from the build service, but it's quite different. However, what it says here, we have two presets, so two generic environments we may want to build. These sources, we have some repositories we want to use and architectures. And then there is this special tag config colon, that means that the configuration of the provided SL15.3 is to be used. So this configuration is provided together with the build script.
Next. So you can, these pbuild files are just a way to spare you the hassle to write anything on the everything of that on the command line. So basically you can have a set of options as a preset, and then you just need to specify the preset instead of typing in lots of arguments.
Yeah. And the underscore config file looks hopefully more familiar. This is basically the project config. So here you see we specify a foreign architecture, and we have some required tooling packages here to do the emulation. Yeah, I could just type pbuild here and it would run. Of course, I need to specify from where I have cloned it, because on this I have not installed any package. So you will see that it downloads everything. It would also tell you if it downloads the assets. And after some time, it will start building. By default, you do not see any build log because it can actually fork multiple instances in parallel. And therefore, you do not want have this mixed up. But there is an option that you can actually see, just start a single job and then you see the log file. I can demonstrate it with another example, the pie hole. So here, this was the example Michael was speaking about. Here we have pie hole FTL spec file. This is an RPM in this situation. This is a RPM which will be cross-compiled. And afterwards, in the next directory, we have a Kiwi file. So you can put any kind of build formats into one directory. You see also the remote assets. It's a bit more ugly, but still readable, I think. Yeah. So here we could say, build and for example single job keyhole FTL. If I do not specify it, everything would be compiled, or everything would be compiled which has changed, because it's not a fixed pipeline, so it works like OBS. It only builds the necessary parts, but if you have a former build, it will reuse this. Yeah, I would say we do not wait for this. But you can try it out. You should really be able to do it, to try it out easily on your own, because we have, there are really no dependencies. So what do we want to do in the near future as next? Of course, we want to extend our templates. We want to demonstrate it with more real-life workloads. We have, of course, also the hope that more workloads and more hardware support gets contributed. So everything is on GitHub. We have the Gigito namespace there. The imaging is still a large area where we need to improve further. The images are way too large still. We want to use basically BusyBox. This is currently blocked by Kiwi and the tooling used by Kiwi. Yes, there are these BusyBox containers, but it's something completely different to build a container or a VM image. So we need to improve there. And I have the feeling that we also need to simplify the build descriptions for images, especially to make it more easy to for more people to add further hardware enablement for more hardware, because this will be a critical part. Aside of that, we need to work on our distribution. So we want to enhance more packages to be cross-buildable, because it's one thing that our tooling allows to execute cross builds, but the packages need to allow it. So we have enhanced a few packages. I forgot which one actually, but the glibc and BusyBox and these packages, and kernel is almost working. But yeah, way more packages should allow to be get cross compiled. And we need to work on the reproducibility. So far, the approach with build compare was always good enough for us, but our competition claims to be bitwise compatible, and that's a measurement for us. The SPDX support is critical to report where every component comes from. So SPDX is an ISO standard. which documents in the end, which sources and which resources got used and are part of the image. We have this to some degree with the report files, but not so much detailed and not in this format. This is something we want to do. And then there is a deployment. So there should be deployment hooks within people that you can directly deploy on some hardware, and also some generic deployment mechanics in the images that you can trigger a redeployment of your workloads. Yeah, the rest are just for references. These are the commands, more or less, which I showed you in the demo. Do you have any more questions? If you do not have the questions right now, then please go to www.gekito.org. There's also a chat. We have the templates. And there's a people documentation. And please really use the external chat and no internal. It would be very helpful. Thank you. Yeah, regarding ignition, Richard, I had a discussion or a discussion with Fabian, I believe. And it sounded like ignition would not be usable for Gekito, but yeah. I mean, we are not here to invent everything on our own, definitely. If it's possible to make a template at least and look how far we can get with that, it would be also wonderful. No, the Gekito is of course not a Slack channel because we use the external, what is it? It's linked, but it's a public channel to allow the OpenSUSE community to join. Yeah, Vincent, the JOS, sure, as I said, the JOS images are just there for reference, more or less. For Gekito, we won't really focus on them because it's from the size, it's not our goal.
So, and the images are, of course, in the current state, more or less proof of concept and nothing final. So, it wasn't even our goal to check how small we can get. So, we didn't have the time for that actually. So we have there's very room for improvement.
But the sources in general should be exchangeable. So that's a goal that the content can be, or the, yeah, the build description can be exchanged from OBS to pbuild and vice versa.
And something because there are comparisons with MicroS and the a bit of a difference is that Gekito aims to fit the customizable Linux a bit better. That is, it's because you can build everything from the packages you want to change from source. It's more like Yocto or so. We have a configuration file and then it builds everything. So it's not so much of just using the binary packages that SUSE provides, but it also allows you to customize the packages you have to.
Sure, but the like speaking from experience with customers, you know, that's how customers are already using SLE Micro in production. So, like what I'm seeing here is Gekito would be an awesome sort of extra string to the bow. You know, yeah, I don't, you know, I think if we had, for example, SLE Micro and OpenSUSE MicroS templates in there, you know, there's going to be customers who want to, you know, use a tool like this, but want to have a read-only root file system. There's going to be customers that want to have tools like this and an update stack and whatever. This, you know, so this, we can use this to kind of feed that way as well as doing it with vanilla OpenSUSE courses as well.
Yeah, then let's try to work on a template. So it's, I mean, yeah, we just didn't have looked inside, but let's just work together on a template and we will see who picks it up. Yeah, Cloud Init is not really used because we do not want to limit us. We can build containers, but containers is just a side feature of pbuild. In general, we really focus on native hardware in first place.
So I think, Adrian, that your Gakita setup tool is kind of modeled after the thing that the Raspberry Pi people already have, right?
Right. I mean,
so that was basically one of the points, so that the people used to the Raspberry Pi feel at home, basically.
Yeah, it's used in some Raspbian-based images like Octoprint and so on. There's more or less a standard that you can configure your system based on your FAT file system partition. Yeah. It's slightly different, but I hope still understandable for the users. So who wants to add a template for further hardware support? Ah, he failed.
Yeah, so one of the, so Gakito is basically, to speak a bit about that, Gakito is kind of two things. It's the tooling, of course, but it's also about building a community for the embedded world, basically, that kind of brings OpenSUSE better into the embedded world. So kind of finding enthusiasts that want to have OpenSUSE on their Raspberry Pi or so. So this is because of, this is basically why Adrian now asks for people getting involved into the project, because one of the main goals is creating a community.
And ideally, we have the OBS project and so on for Gakito would be very small because we really merge everything into our distributions and an upstream. That would be the best situation. So it's really not that we want to duplicate stuff. And if there is existing stuff like Ignition or so, which we can reuse, wonderful. Then we drop everything else.
On the hardware side, have you spoken to Glem in the OpenSUSE community? Because like the amount of different ARM platforms he alone supports in factory is ridiculous.
Yeah, right. I work with Guillaume, but we haven't really discussed this in detail yet. That's true. But we are in good contact in general.
You probably could just steal half of his Kiwi files and trim them down a bit. Yeah. And there you go.
Yeah, the point is these Kiwi files are all JOS in the end, and this is not fitting for us. And the question is how to generalize this that we can have maybe JOS and smaller or embedded-oriented image builds. But ideally, maybe maintaining these together, that would be the best. And the question is, of course, also if Kiwi is always the best imaging tool, I have to say. I mean, we need to make it more easy in Kiwi to add further hardware support. It's not easy enough yet, from my point of view. We need to improve this. We could add also support for other tooling. So it's really, we are not fixed on any tooling. We could be flexible. But it depends very much on the hardware also, I think. But of course, we will keep working on Kiwi because it's our main driver.